The situation, I believe, as far as we know, it's two have fallen. One of them fell about 1,000 metres and did not get up and is believed to be dead. Over.
Understood. We were originally given reports that two people fell 1,000 metres. Can you confirm? Over.
Not sure. There could be, but we simply don't know at the moment. Over.
In the most hostile environment on Earth, 8,500 metres above sea level, a team of climbers are about to embark on the final push to the top of the world.
Going to extreme altitude is like being 100 years old.
You're breathless all the time, even at rest.
But this is no ordinary climbing team.
Oxygen saturation, 62%, figure 62, over.
They are doctors, and they are here to rewrite our understanding of the human body. Experimenting on themselves as they attempt to climb to the summit.
This is really pushing the boundaries of what's possible.
This team will turn Everest into the highest laboratory on Earth.
Why do it? My answer to that would be to be part of one of the most exciting scientific experiments that's existed in the last 20 or 30 years.
It's really quite unpleasant.
But nothing can prepare them for the life and death decisions they'll face.
In the last half hour, she's in complete disregard for human life.
With respect to your doctor, he will die.
The guys on the mountain who are continuing to go up in bad shape, I wouldn't give them a cat's chance of living.
This is the story of an expedition unlike any Everest has seen before. The story of a team of men and women willing to risk everything in the pursuit of knowledge.
Here to do a job and I want to get it done and go home. I'm looking forward to getting home.
This is the story of doctors in the death zone.
Right, steady over. That's steady, you've got me over.
It's the 24th of March 2007. A group of 60 doctors and scientists are flying to the Himalayas. They're here to climb the world's highest mountain, Mount Everest. Lukla Airport in northern Nepal is perched on a cliff 2,800 meters above sea level. It is as far as mechanical transport can take them. 250 people will pass through this airport over the next 3 months. They will form the Caldwell Extreme Everest Expedition, the largest research team ever to come to the Himalayas. But from here, it is a 2-week trek to base camp. Doctors Roger McMorrow and Nigel Hart have been climbing together for 12 years, but coming to Everest will fulfill a lifelong dream.
Everest, the undisputed highest mountain in the world. It was probably the first mountain that I actually ever knew the name of. And as a boy, you hear stories about Everest and climbing Everest and the adventures people have here. It goes back to the first time you get into mountaineering. You know, the beauty of it, the isolation of it, and also the physical challenge. I can't say that I ever thought I could be contemplating trying to get to the summit.
But Everest is a killer. For every 15 people that summit, one dies trying. They are remembered in a memorial 3 days from base camp.
I've been to Everest twice before, and on my first trip I ended up burying somebody up there.
Sandeep Dhillon is a military doctor and the only member of the team to have climbed on Everest before.
I think of all the people in the summit party, I'm probably the most scared and wary of the challenges we're about to face.
14 of the world's highest mountains are in the Himalayas. But the biggest challenge climbing them is nothing to do with technical ability.
Climbing high up on the mountain when there's so little oxygen is almost a dreamlike state. You feel like you're drunk. You feel sort of soporific. Every footstep is an effort of will and physically sort of pushing the body. It's not uncommon to have to take sort of 15 huge breaths like that between each pace, and despite that, you just want to collapse down into the snow.
These doctors haven't come just to climb Everest. They're here to make a discovery. They are hoping to find something that will transform lives back home. Many of the team are intensive care specialists, and they are risking their lives to save patients like this. One in seven of us will be treated in intensive care. After a major accident, traumatic surgery, or during an extreme illness. But for intensive care consultant Mike Grocott, the fight to save a life almost always boils down to one thing. What kills his patients is a lack of oxygen in their blood, or what doctors call hypoxia.
All the people that we see that are sick have hypoxia in some form or another. So they have low oxygen levels, either because their heart isn't working so well, isn't pumping the blood around the body, their lungs aren't working so well, that the oxygen isn't getting into the body. And we see this all the time. It's hard to think of a sick patient who doesn't have problems with hypoxia. And yet it's extraordinarily difficult to study them.
In intensive care, survival often appears random. Some patients can endure extreme levels of hypoxia, whilst others simply die. It is a mystery that Mike Grocott and his team believe can only be answered by putting their own bodies into an identical situation. On Everest, these doctors will become the guinea pigs. They want to see how their bodies adapt to the lack of oxygen at extreme altitude.
We're taking a number of healthy, almost identical individuals, and then we're making them critically hypoxic for about 3 months. How can they do it when our patients are dying with the same levels of oxygen in intensive care?
The further up the mountain they go, the less oxygen they will have to breathe, and the closer they will push their bodies into intensive care.
It may be that the things that predict how people do at high altitude will be the same things that predict whether they would survive a critical illness.
Just doing research without trying to climb the highest mountain in the world is a challenge in itself. They'll be happy when we come back all in one piece.
If they can reach the summit, they will have less oxygen in their blood than people who are critically ill. A level of oxygen so low, they should be dead.
You see people breathe more, cardiac output, so the amount that the heart pumps increases, so there's more oxygen pumped around the body. So the number of very small blood vessels, the capillaries in the muscles, increase as well.
So many people have died on that ridge trying to get up to the summit.
Nervousness about impending disaster, it might not turn out okay.
Grasping for some sort of strangling.
You go first, Mike. Just go forwards and just place it on there. Then I'll go. Right. 2, 3, lift.
This expedition started life 5 years ago and 4,500 miles away from Everest.
We had this idea of doing a research expedition to Everest, and about 4 years ago, we realised that really we either should shut up and stop talking about it or get on and do it.
There was something for at least a year and a half that we discussed in the pub over a pint rather, and weren't really sure that it was actually translatable into reality.
I think that's it.
That looks good. We spent a lot of time sitting outside Parisian street cafes discussing what we might do, and we started putting together the group of people who were likely to be involved. Me as the expedition leader, and we kind of gathered the team as we went along. They're all very experienced high altitude mountaineers.
It's a historical record of my least fit moment.
Mike's wife, Dr. Denny Levitt, is one of the project's research leaders. She's designed many of the experiments they'll carry out on Everest.
I think it would have been very difficult for him to have been involved and me not involved, because it's been very much a life-consuming project for the last year or so. Sometimes it's a challenge your husband being a boss, because he always gets to be right at work, so we have a system where I'm always right at home, so that makes up for it.
Walk backwards.
We're not fantastic climbers, we're not going to break any records on the climbing front, but it's by a long way the largest high-altitude research project that's ever occurred. And I'm not sure that anything like this will be repeated for a very long time.
Lean forward. Go on! Right, to the end of the garden and back. Right,
After 2 weeks of walking, the trek is over. Everest Base Camp is set on a glacier at the foot of the mountain. At an altitude of over 5,000 metres, this tent city is higher than any peak in the Alps.
Brilliant job. Brilliant job. Have a look around too, thank you. Yeah, fantastic.
What are you looking forward to?
And my bed.
A cup of tea would be good.
And then my bed.
Now we're up near 5,000 metres and you're starting to get that shortness of breath, maybe the dry cough, and so the sense of what's ahead really is starting to build.
It's amazing to think that at 5,000 metres we're just halfway up and we're already finding it hard walking and starting to think, oh my goodness, you know, this is a very big mountain. We've a long way to go.
Base camp is so high, there is 50% less oxygen than at sea level. And this makes it a perfect natural laboratory to study the effects of hypoxia, or low oxygen.
We're here with a goal that we believe in and that we think is valuable, and at the same time have the opportunity to live in this environment and potentially to climb to the summit, and that's a unique opportunity. I'm most looking forward to getting back to base camp with everybody else absolutely fine, and knowing that we've done what we came to achieve without causing any harm to anyone. Priorities are very clear in terms of safety first, and then the science, and then the summit.
It's amazing. It's going to be a great place to live.
Over the next few months, 213 people will be studied here on this constantly moving world of ice and rock. These tents house hundreds of thousands of pounds of advanced research equipment. The doctors will conduct over 40 different experiments, looking at every aspect of how the body copes with low oxygen. They will measure every breath and every heartbeat. The tests range from simply stepping on a box to biopsies that look at individual cells.
To look at cellular mechanisms, they need a bit of tissue, and the muscle is actually relatively easy to get to, easier than your brain, or your heart, or your lungs.
Many of the results won't be known until they can analyse them back in the UK.
We've got about 17,000 samples from the expedition as a whole.
The combination of these tests will create the most detailed picture ever assembled of the human body at altitude.
It's a lovely picture of all the tiny red blood cells zooming through the small blood vessels under his tongue.
Some of the experiments are so invasive that they are only conducted on a small group of volunteers.
Bloody hell, it's cold.
The one everyone is dreading is tonometry.
Your height is a lamp tent and they're torturing people in there.
So this is lignocaine jelly. It's local anaesthetic jelly, and it's a water-based jelly, so it'll make the tube slide easily down through the back of Nigel's nose, into his throat, then he's got to swallow it down, and it's got to go all the way down to sit in his stomach over there.
Not only my top five of things that I want to do on this trip or any other trip, to be perfectly honest, but anyway, it's all for the good of science.
Belfast GP Nigel Hart has practiced this test in London. He knows how unpleasant it can be.
I'm not looking forward to this.
Are you ready for this, Nigel?
Yeah.
The experiment is designed to study one of the most common complications in intensive care.
Go for it. Okay, swallow. Chin forward, chin on your chest, and swallow.
As the body becomes more and more hypoxic, it attempts to protect the vital organs from a lack of oxygen by cutting the blood supply to the gut.
The gut is a relatively non-vital organ in the short term, and so the body would draw oxygen away from that to perfuse vital organs like the brain, the lungs. So
this test will measure how Nigel's gut is reacting to the low levels of oxygen on Everest.
It goes into one of the arteries in Nigel's wrist.
You know, this sort of stuff here, people have to tolerate it all day, every day in the hospital. It's quite a good learning opportunity for those of us who are on the other side. Not that I wanted it too often.
Dr. André Vercule is a liver specialist and well practiced at performing this technique in intensive care.
There we go. You can see the pulsing of each beat of Nigel's heart. Ordinarily, if we were doing this at sea level, the blood coming out of here would be bright orange-red colour. But because there's less oxygen being carried by the blood, it's this fetching blue colour.
But Dr. Dan Martin knows the low oxygen on Everest is not enough to exactly mimic intensive care. They need to push Nigel even further.
The other component we can simulate, if you like, is the increased oxygen consumption that sick patients have. They require a lot more oxygen to get over the disease that they're suffering from, and we can increase Nigel's oxygen consumption by getting him to exercise. So although it wouldn't be quite right to make him ill and study him, we can exercise him, which increases the amount of oxygen demand on his body. So we want to try and find the point at which Nigel's gut basically becomes ischemic or lacks oxygen. And in critically ill patients, it may do that to such an extent that the gut may die.
I think what you sometimes forget is you're sitting here and it almost looks like a laboratory, and then you look outside the door and there's the ice fall.
It's all a bit difficult.
The studies at base camp are just the beginning of the team's work. 15 of the doctors are planning to take their experiments to the highest place on Earth.
It just looks like a maze, like a broken maze. It's really hard.
The first obstacle they face is the Khumbu Icefall.
Everest has so much history associated with it, so many books written about it, and the Khumbu Icefall is one of those notorious obstacles that anyone who wants to climb Everest from this side has to get over.
It's basically a continuously moving river of ice, with the ever-present risk that part of it will fall down. And you can see those big blocks down there, some of them the size of houses, and they are coming down from time to time. So
it has been impossible to ignore how unstable the mountain can be.
If a large serac, a large chunk of ice, decides that that's the time for it to fall down when one of our team is walking underneath, there's very little you can do about that. And the only thing you can really do is minimise exposure by getting people through as fast as possible and going through as few times as possible. Behind the icefall and hidden behind the ridge of Nuptse is the Western Khum, this broad, relatively flat valley that goes up towards the Lhotse face.
As they climb to the summit, the doctors will stay at Camp 2 for 7 days.
The route meanders up to Camp 3, which is about halfway up, and then across to the South Col. And up to the South Col, we're into the area colloquially known as the Death Zone. Above the South Col, you can see the southeast ridge heading up into the cloud and Everest summit. And that's the other main area of risk for us, because of the critical lack of oxygen.
Only at this extreme altitude, where there is one-third of the oxygen there is at sea level, can they find the answer to the mystery that has brought them to Everest. How does the human body survive with such low levels of oxygen? As they begin their ascent, the icefall poses a challenge most of the climbers have never seen before. The glacier is 450 metres deep and sliding down the mountain at over a metre a day.
All right.
It is riddled with crevasses that can open and close without warning.
Anything else?
Sandeep is the climbing leader and the only person to have tackled the ladders before.
Everest is a very, very dangerous place. If you were to ask me at this stage how many people I think would get to the top, I'd probably say somewhere between 6 to 8. That's not really making an assessment on individuals.
Nice work. Good job.
That's just the toll that the mountain takes on people, and you know, it'd be difficult to say who I think would or wouldn't be in the summit team.
Quite a long way, isn't it?
If you fell here, you'd load these points here far more than and it's probably safe for them. You really, really don't want to fall here.
Hi, Pixie.
Hi.
Three ladders is just here. Looks all right.
It is truly stunning, though, isn't it?
Warming in there.
Despite the danger, the icefall is one of the most extraordinary places on Earth. A vertical kilometer of shifting ice, breaking and cracking as it flows. Every day in this jumbled world is unique.
Oh,
it's hot. Kind of messy over to our left. Just see all these blocks come tumbling down. Just keep going. This looks horrible. It's tough getting it. Oh, crazy. Breathe, breathe.
To climb through the ice fall will be a grueling experience for Mike and the team.
Okay, let's go. Not a place to pause.
What slows them down is not their fitness or strength, but the lack of oxygen. At this altitude, the thin air is so suffocating they can never climb fast enough to exhaust their legs.
Okay.
The body reacts by attempting to get more blood to the oxygen-starved muscles. The lungs breathe harder, sucking in more air. The blood is thicker with extra cells to carry oxygen, and the heart beats faster. But this traditional understanding of how the body copes isn't enough to explain one thing. Why do some people, no matter how fit, struggle to perform at high altitude?
Mike was an absolute star, as you can see. He's carrying a lot of my gear. So I was struggling a bit earlier on, particularly when we started, so it was really cold. Didn't think I'd have got up here if he hadn't helped. So, but we're here in one piece at last, which is excellent news. I think I'm going to have a cup of tea.
Mike and the team believe what causes this difference is not how much oxygen is pumped around the body, but how well the body uses that oxygen. Understanding this is the major goal of the expedition. Here at Camp 2, they will set up a new lab, repeating the tests they've done all the way from sea level. But now the conditions are much tougher. Here, temperatures will drop to below minus 20, and then soar in the heat of the sun to over 40 degrees. Living here will be more like camping in a desert than on a glacier. And yet they are about to perform experiments that require all their skills as scientists.
Now, Dan, you going to feel a scratch?
At every stage of the climb, the team will be taking a blood sample straight from an artery. Measuring the level of oxygen in blood is a test Mike would do every day in intensive care.
You all right, Dan? Just the arterial blood is the blood that is pumped out of the heart, having been through the lungs, so it's the most oxygenated. So it gives us a measure of how much oxygen the tissues are seeing. Out.
At sea level, a healthy person will have 10 to 14 units of oxygen in their blood. Someone who is critically ill, around 8.
So we've just analysed Dan's arterial gas sample, and it's just astonishingly low. I've never ever seen a sample, a content of oxygen in the blood as low in somebody who's still alive. It's 4.47 partial pressure of oxygen in kilopascals, which is a third of what it is at sea level. I've just never seen, even on somebody on an intensive care unit, critically ill with terrible lung damage, I've never seen a level this low, ever. You should be worried.
It's a beautiful morning, and this is my incredibly beautiful and historic temporary home. Behind me here is Everest itself, the highest mountain in the world, and as you can see from it's a cloudy looking bit, it's pretty windy and cold up there this morning, so we're certainly not going anywhere today. Over there is Lhotse, another 8,000 metre peak, which is the fourth highest mountain in the world. This big tent here is, as far as we know, is currently the highest laboratory in the world, until we put one up there next week, that is.
Having established that all the team have levels of oxygen in their blood that mean they should be dead, their next test is designed to reveal why they are still alive. To do this, they have brought an exercise bike nearly 6,500 metres up the mountain.
Okay, that's perfect.
This is the most important experiment for the Extreme Everest team. The foundation of the whole expedition.
Yeah.
Just got to go as hard as, and as long as you can.
Test. Prepare. Stop left.
The machine knows when you're fibbing.
Yeah, it knows.
By exercising on this bike, Sandeep will push his body to the very limit. It's a test he first performed in London 3 months ago.
It's one of our key hypotheses on this whole trip is whether actually the way your cells use the oxygen changes when you're at altitude, or when there's not much oxygen around.
They believe that Sandeep's muscles are using less oxygen up here to do the same amount of exercise he did at sea level.
Really good, Sandeep. Excellent. Doing really well. Drive those legs. What we think happens is your cells basically tune up, a bit like a car engine, so you can get more miles for the buck, really. You can do more work for the same amount of oxygen. Doing very well. And that would help explain why people with very low levels of oxygen in the blood are still able to perform amazing feats like climbing Everest.
Denny thinks that Sandeep's cells have adapted over the last few months and somehow have become more efficient. They think this happens in intensive care as well. Some patients respond to treatment better than others because their cells might be more efficient at using oxygen.
We can clearly see that some people have exactly the same number of red blood cells and their heartbeat is the same and their breathing is the same, but one performs far better than the other.
It's a revolutionary new theory.
If we could tune their cells into a more efficient state, we may be able to, in the future, improve their outcome in intensive care. That's why I'm here on Everest, putting myself through this, so that I can hopefully improve their outcome in the future.
I think in our wildest dreams, what we would love to see is that some people have certain genes which allow them to use oxygen more efficiently than others. And so what we're really, really hoping from this trip is that we could target treatment to poor oxygen users. It's quite a wild and big thing, but we may go some stages towards identifying those mechanisms.
Really good.
Fantastic, Danny.
Keep pushing left round.
But to get the clearest picture of what is going on in their bodies, they need to take the exercise bike to the most extreme environment possible. They will set up their final lab on the South Col. The climbers will spend 2 days at 8,000 metres testing themselves to exhaustion. If these experiments prove that their cells are more efficient, they may be able to develop a treatment that would save thousands of lives. To get there, they must first tackle the Lhotse face. This 1,000 metre sheer wall of ice towers above the Western Coombe. It takes 2 days to climb the nearly vertical slopes with a constant threat of avalanche.
Yesterday we had an extraordinarily sad event. We were in camp doing studies, but the radio traffic gradually revealed that unfortunately one of the Sherpas working with a different team had been hit by an ice avalanche and as best we understand had been killed instantly. And that obviously upsets our Sherpas greatly and all the members of our group.
It's just a bit shocking at how easily a life can be snuffed out in an environment where we're planning to walk exactly the same path in a few days' time. And that's what I think is playing on all our minds.
I mean, we're going on with our experiments this morning and you almost feel like saying, oh, just close the door and, you know, not bother this morning.
It's very difficult to justify any reason for putting yourself at any extra risk when you have a wife and two small children. This morning's really focused our mind an awful lot on what we're doing here.
I came here to do a job with a lot of effort being put into it, and I want to do that job, but at the same time, keen to get home.
The weather is changing high on Everest. The threat of snow will make the mountain much more unstable. With the science completed at Camp 2, Mike chooses to return to base camp rather than continuing to climb with the increased risk of avalanche.
Yeah,
came down on the advice of our Sherpas because there was warning of snow, which increases the avalanche risk. As it happens, it didn't snow, but while we were walking through the Western Coombe, there was a big serac collapse, which caused hundreds of tons of ice to come rushing down the slope towards us. Fortunately, it stopped before it reached us, but good thing to be done.
Living at high altitude has proved much harder than they had expected.
Hey, my day.
It's been a great week. A lot of hard work, but everything done we wanted to do scientifically, it was brilliant. It's nice to be warm again. Nice to be able to breathe again.
Virtually everything we did has not been done before. A few things that have certainly not been done in the same sort of degree of fidelity, so we're really delighted.
The appetite effects are quite a lot, so you might have noticed we've all lost quite a lot more weight. I think the record is 11 kilos so far.
To climb Everest, the team need to be as strong and healthy as possible. Even a simple cold could stop them. They will wait here at base camp, trying to regain their strength until the weather on the summit clears. Entertainment is thin on the ground at base camp. The climbers have to find their own ways of keeping busy.
Oh! Can control it very well at home, at sea level, but here it's not quite so easy. Steady. This is the highest flying model helicopter in the universe.
Do you know why he's in here? Because hard drive to work? His external hard drive wouldn't work, so we put him in here.
The disk drive is working!
Is it working?
Yeah, absolutely perfect! Who did that? I bet that was Grocott.
Yes. You ready? You ready? No, let's go. Let's go. Get on.
The climbers have been waiting for the weather to clear on the summit for nearly 3 weeks.
It's pretty good in that humidity is pretty well zero, precipitation is zero, right up until about the 1st or 2nd of June. So that's very good. The only thing we've got is the jet stream, and that is tracking from a northwesterly down to a sort of southeasterly direction, so it's getting closer and closer towards Nepal. Wind speed will be the one thing that stops them. I don't think there's going to be any snow for the next 10 days or so. So it's just the wind.
It's 6 a.m. 15 of the climbers are getting ready to leave base camp for the last time. 5 years of planning has brought them to this point. They will have one chance to climb to the summit. The smallest problem could mean abandoning their science for good.
I can't find my gloves.
Building ourselves up. It's all in the mind.
As intensive care specialists, all the doctors are aware of the dangers they face climbing at altitude.
I think everybody's feeling pretty strong. And it looks like we've got about between 7 and 10 days of good weather without high winds. I mean, looking at the top of the mountain today, it looks really calm. So fingers crossed that the weather holds and we can get up and get down safely. I'm just looking forward to bringing everybody back down again in about a week's time.
Quite excited, ready to go. Big day today. A big week ahead of us, but I think everyone's a bit of a mixture of excitement and nervousness, really, to be honest.
Terrified today.
Did you bring the guidebook?
I do, I love it.
What terrifies the climbers the most is not avalanches or frostbite.
6 to 8 hours of misery coming
through. It's the effects the low oxygen will have on their brains. Protecting the brain is Mike's top priority in intensive care. Without oxygen, cells die in minutes, leaving a patient permanently brain damaged or even dead. When the brain suffers a major trauma, like in a car accident, it swells and pushes against the inside of the skull. As the pressure builds, less oxygen gets to the brain, causing a spiraling effect. The same thing can happen on the mountain. The low levels of oxygen are enough to trigger the same kind of brain swelling. It's called high-altitude cerebral edema, or HACE. It is the most serious effect of climbing at altitude, and nowhere on Earth is the threat greater than on the summit of Everest. At nearly 30,000 feet is the cruising altitude of a jumbo jet. If a climber were to be dropped straight onto the summit, their brain would shut down, stopping them breathing, and they'd suffocate in minutes. To counter these effects, the extreme Everest climbers have been training their bodies to cope with the low oxygen. Over the last 6 weeks, they have been climbing the mountain in stages. With each trip, they go a little higher. But despite this cautious ascent, some of the team have found climbing beyond Camp 2 difficult.
First off, my heart started going at a terrible pace, and then I just started to feel very woozy. Not so much woozy as like I was going to black out. I thought, wow, the altitude kicks in quickly, doesn't it? And I thought I was stuffed. And I was breathing really fast. Honestly, everything was just going, woo, black, can't see, woo, I'm going to pass out here. I was thinking, shoot.
You're thinking, shoot.
Yeah, you're thinking, yeah. Darn, I got to go down as well.
Nigel Hart is lucky. The effects of the low oxygen have turned out to be mild. But climbing at this extreme altitude is a game of Russian roulette.
I mean, the most important thing for us to understand is whether he's going to be walking wounded or stretcher case. I feel happier probably with Andre short roping him on the way down.
For one of the team, the worst has happened.
There should be about 30 cylinders up there. Just keep on using it. When
and the next, did you give 8 milligrams?
Whilst climbing on the Lhotse face, anaesthetist Patrick Doyle has become confused and disorientated. The classic symptoms of HACE.
Yeah, welcome back.
Interesting. Bizarre thing is, you know, I feel 1,000% better, and I think, well, what's all the fuss about?
Yeah.
I think, I could go back up there, but it's just...
How do you feel about not going back up?
It's a bit emotional not being able to do it, but I always said I'm going to be totally sensible, and...
It's good to have you back down, Steve, but...
Yeah.
The world got it for you as well.
I didn't think it would be me.
Staying at Camp 2 should allow Pat to recover, but he can't climb any higher.
You look better than we could have hoped, you say.
After 2 months of preparation, his summit dreams are over.
Yeah.
Pat was one of the strongest climbers, and the effect of the altitude on him has shocked the whole team.
He sounds well. He wouldn't have gone up if he was feeling sick.
Yeah. So it sounds very much like HACE.
Yeah, he sounds good, yeah.
It's difficult to deal with in hospital.
Yeah, absolutely.
Cool, well, base camp, this is my go, man.
This is safely.
He's in the right place with the right people.
Yeah.
They all know that above 8,000 metres, the critically low levels of oxygen mean they will run the risk of suffering permanent brain damage.
OK, we've got, at the moment, an uncertain medical situation up here. It's Pat, and he's probably got a touch of cerebral edema. He's hopefully going to get better pretty soon.
I'd have thought if he's well here, he'll want to stay here for the rest, but I would have thought... He's pretty sensible and wouldn't want to go back up.
With Pat ill, Mike has to reorganise the team. If they are to reach the summit, they can't afford any more delays.
With at least you two together.
We've sent the first two groups up.
Yeah.
Which will only delay us by a day.
Yeah.
We're going to have a look at the weather again.
Yeah.
The team has split in two. Sandeep is leading an advanced party to Camp 3. Mike and the main climbers will follow a day behind. getting to Camp 3 means climbing the Lhotse face. Doing this is a monotonous exercise, hour after hour of hauling yourself up a sheer wall of ice, clipping off and on ropes every few meters. As the oxygen drops, the effects on the brain become more profound. Even the simplest of tasks becomes challenging.
The history of deaths on Everest is littered with stories of terrible, simple mistakes. There are people who won't do up their harnesses properly. There are people who, when it comes to clipping in and out of a rope, they simply can't be bothered. The effort of leaning down, unclipping, and clipping onto the top rope is too much for a lot of people. And they start to think that they'll move quicker if they don't do those things.
The climb to Camp 3 is only 700 metres, but it has taken over 5 hours. Dan, Mariam and Vijay are the first to arrive. Chris follows behind, and Sandeep comes last to make sure nobody gets left on the Lhotse face. It's been a hard day, and the team need rest before continuing tomorrow. This small cluster of tents is a stop-off for all the teams on Everest. From here, the final camp before the summit is just a few hours' climb away.
I had a bit of one actually, my first one. I think I'm dehydrated rather than altitude wise. I feel good. I need to get the stove on and get going.
Get some booze going.
A climber from another team is struggling to make the last few metres before camp.
He could barely move. All the time, he's breathing as hard and as fast as he can, but just having complete air hunger and feeling that nothing's going on. If you combine that with somebody who's got this single thought in his mind that if he continues to follow this rope, he's one step nearer reaching the summit of Everest. Actually, all he was doing was climbing closer and closer to death.
And at that point, I just thought, if we're going to be stood here, then we might as well go down and help.
Vijay, don't go down there without being clipped on. Just clip on and stay safe.
It's very treacherous ground around there, and if you take a fall, and you're not clipped into anything, then you're just going to keep on going to the bottom of the Lhotse face.
Oh, my God.
And he was really in bad shape. When I arrived at him, he was completely incoherent, just making gargling noises.
Can you take his pack, Vijay?
I tried to give him some water, but he couldn't swallow. I think he had, the classical signs of haste, really.
The doctors realise that this is a potentially fatal situation. But the sick climbers team seem reluctant to help. They call their own doctor at base camp for advice.
In the last half hour, I've seen complete disregard for human life. I've seen a bunch of guys sit in their tents while they watch their team member struggle like hell up those ropes, and they just looked on, took photographs, took out the video camera, came to work, guys didn't even know him, to step in and drag him up, and they thanked us for it. But what are they doing? That's everything that is wrong with people.
You asked about him in his eyes, and I wouldn't pretend to swallow that. If you shouted him enough, his name, he opened his eyes. That's yeah, I know. He looks really dehydrated, he's cold, clammy.
With light failing, there is very little time to act. If the climber is to be carried down the Lhotse face, they must leave immediately.
Hello, my name is Daniel. I'm a British doctor. The man here is very unwell.
With the other team reluctant to take advice, Dan calls the doctor directly to try and persuade him the situation is extremely serious.
I think his life is in danger. If he comes to Camp 2, our doctors there may be able to look after him. We have a lot of doctors at Camp 2.
There you go.
Yeah, we need a stretch right away.
Just seen another guy.
unconscious on the ropes.
On the ropes passing the camp, another crisis is unfolding. A climber returning from the summit is in trouble.
Your emotions are torn between concern for the people that you're trying to help. You're concerned about the health and morale of your team that are now running around expending energy and potentially making themselves sick when they should be resting. But actually you realise you're fairly helpless.
VJ, what's the score?
They say he's tired but they're not prepared to
be really tired. Fine, it's not our decision, VJ. We can only help. VJ, they can still get this guy down. And that is the right treatment. VJ! VJ!
VJ! They'll get him down.
VJ!
VJ!
Dealing with two casualties will leave the team dangerously stretched.
VJ, just come back, ready? VJ!
VJ!
Come back!
Leave it! It's awful to say this. We're going to be ending up having to look after ourselves rather than endanger ourselves.
VJ!
I've never ever been in this position, but as I say, we have to look after ourselves. Ourselves in a right pickle.
Drugs and oxygen can help, but the only guaranteed treatment is to descend to a lower altitude. Taking the climber down will save his life.
EJ, you're a good man.
But time is running out for the other climber. His team are still making no attempt to leave. Some deep radios for support.
Okay, I'll see what I can do. I doubt it will be much help, but we'll see what we can do.
He wants to get everyone mobilised, to put maximum pressure on this team to bring their climber down.
Okay, I'll go over to the camp and discuss it with the doctor and tell it as it is, over. It's unclear whether they're simply unconcerned or don't understand, or don't want to pay their shippers for an extra carry. I mean, the motivation is confusing. I can't imagine anybody that I climb with just saying, oh, well, it'll be okay.
I've spoken to the doctor and the team and the leader and the Sirdar, and they don't seem to feel any great degree of urgency, unfortunately.
It's very frustrating being down here, not being able to do
anything.
It
is, yeah, it is.
You now wait to see if he lives or dies, don't you?
Yeah.
If they're not going to accept any help, then...
Okay, thanks so much. Done out. Breathe this guy the right out. One more time.
Yeah. We are all doctors with a lot of experience in England in high-altitude medicine. And we believe that if he stays the night here, he has a very high chance of dying. And our advice to you is that you get him down immediately. The summit is not important. Here's important.
He should have been turned around a long time ago.
I just thought I'd talk with my doctor down there. With respect to your doctor, he will die. If your doctor is your doctor here or down there? Okay. Well, we are doctors who are here. We've seen your friend, and we don't think that he will survive.
Thanks for your advice.
Okay.
They have finally agreed to take their climber down. But it is too late. Night is falling, and it is too dangerous to descend the Lhotse face.
Dan, in particular, spent a lot of that evening treating this guy. The impression that we had was that they were prepared to allow one of their team members to potentially die so that he wouldn't have to sacrifice their high position on the mountain and therefore their summit attempt.
It has been an exhausting experience. They have only just prevented a death. Despite being physically drained, early tomorrow the doctors will push on to Camp 4. When they get there, they will set up the highest laboratory the world has ever seen.
There's a lot of drama going on the mountain.
Over the next 2 days, they will be tested as scientists, stretched as doctors, and pushed beyond their limits as climbers.
No handles.
No,
not handles.
We've just got here, but we're just going to turn around and go back down. It's the right thing to do, you know?
If one person is up there and they're close to death and nobody's rescuing them, there's nothing we can do about that.
But nothing can prepare them for life in the death zone.
I don't like working off luck.
Night, Danny, over.
Night, Danny. You got me.
2 is next Sunday at 8 here on BBC Two. Coming up, Michael Palin's New Europe on BBC One, the comic and tragic story of a life-changing friendship here on 2, and the highest hospital in the world, Everest ER, on BBC Four.